In this video, I want to talk about how to make air gaps and what are their benefits. But let's first examine, why do we need air gaps? Why do we need this thing called air gap? What are they? Why do we need them? So if you look at our back end of the line of any microprocessor, it looks like this. It has different level of wiring. The lowest levels connect the shortest distance, are called local. Then you have intermediate interconnects, and then you have global wiring or global interconnects. And there are different components of delay. So there's a driver delay, that is a transistor which is driving it. And then there's the RC delay, which is associated with the resistance of this wire and the coupling that it gets with these all these other capacitors. So it turns out that this RC delay is the dominant delay for intermediate and global wires. So if your length of your interconnect exceeds a certain particular critical length, then this RC delay becomes the the most dominant component, which is limiting your microprocessor performance or your latency. So wouldn't it be nice if we could somehow reduce this capacitance in this RC term? So the dielectric, which is currently in between these interconnect, that has if it's silicon dioxide, it has a K value of 3.9. People add fluorine and other carbon elements to silicon dioxide to lower its K value, and they can reduce it to somewhere between 2.5 to 2.7. but wouldn't be it nice that if we can fill this up with the air, which has a dielectric constant, as you all know, of 1. So that's that's quite a different difference from 2.5. So that's one of the thing that this air gap technology can help us achieve. We also looked at NAND flash memory. So NAND flash memory has this one of the prime limitation of scalings over there is these fringe capacitance, or these capacitance that you get between two floating gates. So I'm showing here these two different cross sections. One is along the word line, and then another one is along the bit line. And these black capacitances are the good capacitances. That is the one we want. So we want our floating gate to couple to our control gate. We want our floating gate to couple to our substrate. So these are all good capacitances. But you get these extra red capacitances, which are essentially these capacitance where my floating gate is coupling to this other particular nearby cell, and it's coupling this floating gate here, it's coupling to this floating gate on the adjacent cell on the bit line. Over here, this floating gate is coupling to this other floating gate along the word line. And so you have all these other bad capacitances. So wouldn't it be nice that if I can, if I can, instead of having filling this up with dielectric, I have essentially an air gap over here. And so I have nothing but vacuum over here. And so that way I can substantially reduce these fringe capacitances. So that's the main idea behind the air gap. And next I want to show you some experimental data that what actually happens if you put an air gap. So here's an example where people try to introduce air gap between two adjacent copper lines in the back end of the line process flow, and you can see that it reduces your capacitance between these two lines by 50%, while the resistance of course remains the same because we did nothing to these copper wires, so their resistance remains the same. Another result which we didn't expect, but we got this extra benefit for free, was that my leakage between my leakage current between these two lines. So if I have these two metal lines and I have these dielectric between, then even though it's an insulator, at some voltage, if we apply a very high voltage at this particular interconnect, it would start to have some leakage current. So this is the leakage current which I get. Well, if I don't have an air gap, if I just have a silicon dioxide, versus if I have an air gap, I see, orders of magnitude reduction in my leakage current, and that would mean essentially better reliability. So I'm quite happy about happy about this air gap. And here's some additional experimental data. So that data I showed you was on one particular data point. Here's a probability distribution. So again, you can clearly see that if you have a structure filled with oxide versus if you have a structure filled with the air gap, you see a substantial reduction in your overall interconnect capacitance. And another benefit that you get again for free is that your electromigration, which is becoming increasingly major concern in your interconnect, so your electromigration performance also improves with this air gap. So shown here is your electromigration without an air gap, and you can see over here that electromigration, which is measured over here as the number of hours your interconnects can sustain that stress, again increases if you have an air gap. And the reasoning for that is that if you have an air gap and you are producing your stress over here, that stress can easily be absorbed by this air gap layer. So that stress can kind of deform this air gap, but still retain the integrity of this copper line. So here is another chart showing the advantage actually experimentally observed with the air gap technology in NAND flash memory. So as I talked about, if I introduce the air gap, I can substantially reduce my capacitance between two floating gates. So I have this capacitance between floating gate, and now since I have filled it up with air, so I can clearly see that the capacitance, so between this floating gate and this floating gate, so this capacitance is now substantially reduced with the air gap. This is the actual data from a Intel Micron flash memory chip. And another thing which happens is that you get a much tighter distribution of threshold voltages for your programming for your program cells. So again, this is a cumulative curve for a very large data set, and you can see that if you place silicon nitride between these two cells, which has a higher K, and then you replace it with silicon oxide, which has a lower K, and then finally you replace it with an air gap. So as you do so over here, as you replace from silicon nitride to oxide to air, you see a much more tighter distribution in terms of your threshold voltages. So clearly, air gap is a pretty cool thing. It can give you a lot of benefits. So the next question is, how do I make them?